Now we are on our first panel, which is building community relations through sport. Now, as you can see, there's been a minor plot twist in that Andrew Trimble clearly isn't here due to reasons out of his control. He's probably stranded with snow, probably up in Belfast. But as a, I mean, he's a perfect substitute for this entire thing. We have Jim Roddy, former CEO of Derry City Football Club. In person here with me, we have Maura McMenamin, who is the Community and Health Manager with Ulster GAA, and we have Elaine Nolan, Participation Director with Cricket Ireland. Ladies, great to have you. Jim, hope you're well and hope you can hear me.
All good, Joanne, thank you.
That's good, Jim. Maura, if you don't mind if I start with you. I suppose Health and Health Manager and Community Wellbeing within the GAA, it's now kind of very focused on, you know, the healthy webinars, the healthy club situations going on at the moment. Can you bring us through, for people who don't know what the Healthy Club initiative is, how it started and how it's bringing communities together?
Yeah, thanks, Joanne. So I suppose the health and wellbeing drive within the GAA has been going on. Well, I mean, sport, everything that we're doing is very much involved around health and wellbeing, but formally has been on the GAA agenda since 2013. And we've seen the Healthy Club programme develop from that. And we had our first phase back in 2013. And thankfully now we have completed up to phase four and we've just embarking on phase five now. I'm obviously representing Ulster GAA here today, but I know there's some members of the National Community and Health Department here as well. So it's a national GAA initiative supported by Irish Life. And it's something that's really, you know, it brings clubs to the point where they can use their influence in their community, their standing, the audience that they have, to really just try and embed more healthy behaviours and attitudes, not just in the club and through the members, but also to the wider community.
And I assume part of it is like healthy eating, getting out, getting your extra minutes of exercise a day. It's not necessarily focused on kicking or hitting a ball over a bar.
No, certainly not. And what we do find is that most of the activity that's involved in the Healthy Club programme is actually away from the core games that we, and the core training that would take place anyway within a GAA club. So very much to do with our mental fitness, physical activity, additional physical activity, reaching out to members, again, not just club members, but to members of the wider community around a range of things, Zumba, yoga, you name it. There's so many innovative things that go on. The minister just spoke about the likes of tracks around pitches. So walking tracks, running programs, all of those kinds of things have been really, really popular. But moving on to things like healthy eating, you know, even things like smoking cessation, looking at alcohol and drugs, all the issues that really we find a lot of our communities are struggling with at the moment.
Elaine, if you don't mind if I come to you, you are obviously a Participation Director at Cricket Ireland and you're running an incredible initiative at the moment where you're going into direct provision centres and you're trying to not only create, hopefully, cricket stars of the future, but you're actually trying to cultivate community leaders. Can you talk to us a little bit what that is and what your role is basically?
Yeah, brilliant. Thanks, John. So back in 2019, we started getting an awful lot of inquiries from agencies that were working with direct provisions and support groups around saying we've a number of residents and people here who are just obsessed with cricket, what do we need to do and how do we do it? So we kind of ran a few small initiatives back in 2019 where we went in and we delivered something, but we were coming away and it wasn't necessarily carrying on when we were gone. So in 2020, with thanks to Sport Ireland, our innovation fund, it gave us the opportunity to actually think, how do we build capacity within the direct provision centres and for the residents and the people involved, so that when we walk away that they have the opportunity and the ability to carry on with the programs. And the program's called Cricket Connects and it's kind of morphed into a, you know, we deal with unconscious bias, intercultural training, leadership components, disability and inclusion training. And then we also do the kind of cricket specific technical side of things. So even if they want to go and set up their cricket team or they want to carry on with their cricket, they can. But actually, we were hoping to build greater confidence in them so that they can go out within their wider community and say, I can volunteer in your space, or, you know, just even that self-awareness and leadership and you know, confidence building component. And we've had some really super success in the last while. We've had a bit of failure and we've learned a lot from it. And actually the innovation process with Sport Ireland has kind of, I suppose, given us the freedom to fail in the space and iterate and innovate. But we've really brilliant, your hometown, Mill Street, we've a good connection with Drashan, direct provision, and we had five people go through the leadership program, and they have gone and set up their own cricket program, and they have 45 kids turning up on a weekly basis for activity and fun, and then they've reached out to their wider community to engage, and they've started kind of connecting. Hopefully we'll see a cricket pitch and a cricket team show up in Mill Street, which would be fantastic. But you know, it's been a learning for us, and really impactful actually for the team and Cricket Ireland as well, to get out and to meet people and to learn stories and learn that the conversation is about who you are, and the relationship that you build, opposed to the transactional that sometimes we get into sport of delivering a program and getting the numbers out, that actually we're going more transformational of we're going in, we're investing, but we're getting, you know, people with leadership skills and confidence to go out into their community and provide greater activity.
And you literally can't put a value on that, you know, which I think a lot of people tend to kind of forget about as well. Just a reminder to everyone, you can ask questions. So if you are online, raise your hand at the bottom of your screen, use that button, type in your question through the chat, and I will get to it eventually. If you are physically here with us, there will be people here with roving microphones. So just raise your hand, and they will get to you. They'll get to you fairly quickly. They're quite fit. Jim, over to you. I hope you're getting on very well up there. Football, we had a great discussion about football and soccer and identity and stuff like that. And a key part of what I found most interesting about you was that you're obsessed with getting people to get outside of their comfort zone. Can you talk to us a little bit about how you get people outside their comfort zone? What have their reactions been? And can you give us an example of where you actually push someone so far beyond outside their comfort zone, they actually, they thrived, not just survived, but they thrived.
Yeah, well thank you, Joanna. I'm sorry I can't be there in person, but as you quite rightly described, the weather was pretty horrendous here today, so there was a lot of snow and I couldn't travel. But yes, look, using soccer that I was involved in, which is a common language, it's a common theme. It doesn't matter what background you're from or what, you know, what community you're from. People get involved in the sport, but using that as the actual basis for bringing people together. I was lucky enough to be involved with my own club here in Derry City Football Club, and we play in the League of Ireland, which is outside Northern Ireland, and we're quite unique in that we're playing in a different league than the League of our country. So we all know the reasons for that. We all know the background, the troubles in the north, and the conflict that was going on here at the time. But at the same time, it opened up the opportunity for me to reach out to clubs in Northern Ireland that hadn't played at the Brandywell. And I did so with Limfield in 2004. It was not met widely with approval from a lot of people in the city and region at that time. But we hadn't played Limfield for over 30 years, I think about 32 years. But their chairman was very keen that it happens. Our own Deputy First Minister was very keen that it happened. So I met with the residents in a greater area around the Brandywell Stadium. There was a very mixed response to it. A lot of people were very worried that it might create some trouble. And others were very helpful and worked with us to deliver what turned out to be a great occasion. We had a packed stadium and old acquaintances were renewed. Now, none of that was without risk. And none of this is without risk. And actually building community relations where they've been fractured isn't done very easily, but using sport and using football as a common language, a common theme, is a great way of doing it, and it just opens up the doors to so many other things, and that's why I'd be a massive advocate of an All-Ireland Professional Soccer League, as opposed to United, the two teams, and the one Irish team. I think the identity of this is so important, and most of us have our allegiances and our identity with our soccer club. And we might have one with the national team. That almost comes secondary to quite a few. But when we're not interfering with people's identity and we get them attached to their club, bring them together with other clubs is a real common theme. And we're bringing people together who may not have been together for quite some time. And that's very, very important.
Yeah, I think one resounding theme as well of all the participants here is that we also can't be afraid of failure. I know, Elaine, you had mentioned about, you know, you have failed a couple of times. How do you like eradicate that fear? Because I am sure Sport Ireland do not like if you go back to them and you're like, hey, we failed, but it's fine, we'll go again.
Actually, I think that's kind of changed in the innovation funding in the project and the Dr. Carl Thomas and Cormac and the guys at Sport Ireland have actually, I think sport's getting into that space of, you know, fail fast. And I'm not talking about grand failures of things, but actually it didn't work. What can we learn from it? And the core component that they've brought in is the roof going to blow off? The core component brought in is this kind of customer discovery and Minister Chambers talked about, of actually listening to the communities and ensuring that we're delivering on a needs basis and people are getting to shape what we're delivering to them. Because as a sport, we sometimes go in and say, this is our sport and this is how we do it. But actually the limitations of that environment and, you know, doesn't necessarily allow the sport to thrive, and having the flexibility of knowing maybe, you know, I can fail, but I'm going to shape it the way you need it to be shaped. So we're still getting the sport across, we're getting people active, but it actually fits within their environment. And that community sense of being able to, you know, bridge people together, the traditional side of the sport and then the new people coming in, I think that's the important piece of it. So I think we're getting better at failing as sports, but as long as we're kind of iterating and improving as we go.
Yeah, it's kind of mad because sports, okay, fair enough, a failure is if you lose on the day, but it's the only place where you can pick yourself up, rebuild your game plan and go again. So it's kind of weird that doesn't, well, it's now starting to exist within the, you know, administration side of sport. It's something, you know, that should be worked on as well. Maura, you know, we're obviously talking about, you know, reaching out to communities, bridging gaps, you know, stuff like that. We were talking about how you're going into kind of different schools and you're approaching with a new kind of, it's totally fine as long as you're all fit. Like, how are you going into different places who would never have identified with GAA or played GAA or didn't even want to be near it? How have you managed to break down those barriers?
Yeah, it's probably one of those things, it takes a long time. Yes, you'll certainly make maybe a phone call to a school, for example, who wouldn't, you know, been traditionally associated with the GAA, and you might get a very positive response. Others may take a wee bit of time, and you might need just to spend that wee bit more time trying to, I suppose, see their point of view, but also, you know, everything that we're doing is to the benefit of the participants that we want to get involved. So it does take a lot of time, but thankfully there's so much work going on in this space that you're really starting to see the fruits of the labour. And I mean, we have been doing this for quite some time, and we've been very well supported by the likes of Peace Players. I see Gareth in the audience and stuff around some of the things that we've been doing around the Game of Three Halves and things like that. Whereby this work is ongoing anyway. Schools are actually a really good place to get into because, you know, we have young people there. They're, you know, a captive audience, and whether they want to or not, sometimes they just have to do these things. But it builds so much relationships in terms of even schools mixing with each other through a common thing, like, for example, a sport. So it is a bit of persistence. It's a bit of don't take things personally, and it's just keeping, I suppose, being resilient, but also confident in what it is that you're actually offering. And, you know, we all, anyone who's invested in sport knows the value that it brings. So, you know, if you can't find a way, one way, you find another way around it. So, and back to what Elaine was saying, I mean, we've failed on many things that we've done, but I suppose when you fail, you learn, and that's just the way it's moved on. And we have evolved in terms of how we've done things, but the likes of funding that we've got from the likes of the Peace Programme money and things like that. We have Sport for Peace Days, the Sport Uniting Communities Programme. We have a very, very good working relationship with Ulster Rugby and the Irish Football Association through a number of different funded programmes which fund staff, which is so vital, that money, because it lets us work together collaboratively as three large, I suppose, sporting organisations. And we do so much together, but we have so much in common. And I think as we've been able to spend time in those programmes, the volunteers, the club volunteers on the ground, have really come to realise and value the work that we do collectively together, and then how they can learn from other sports. So it's been a hugely, hugely beneficial process, but it does take time. And thankfully, and I think that's a key thing, the investment in this kind of work has to be a long-term investment, because a 2 or 3 year programme here or there just doesn't make the impact that it needs to make.
Yeah, you can't short-term plan people's expectations or their willingness. You know, people will do what they want to do when they want to do, and if they're pushed, they definitely won't do it any bit further.
Absolutely.
Jim, I think you've probably sent down the storm, to be honest, because it got a little bit windy there. But if I can ask you, we were talking about youth participation, and you were saying how if you go into any local ground or any park, you know, wherever you are, if you put down 4 jumpers for goalposts, loads of kids will just come over, they won't care who they are, and they'll just kick a ball. Is that something that you've noticed is happening more as the generations progress? Or do you think that's just because football speaks to a specific unity that maybe another sport wouldn't, or another facet of life wouldn't necessarily speak to?
Yeah, well, look, football's so easy. All you need is an actual ball. And as I said, the area on, Joanne, something like goalposts and kids will play. And there doesn't need to be any allegiances to anything else. They just play the game and they can be invited on the pitch and play whatever the pitch is like. And it's such a universal sport right throughout the world. It doesn't matter whether you're back streets in Brazil or playing somewhere like Brook Park in Derry or Phoenix Park in Dublin. You know, the kids will just play. But it's how we actually utilize that and build on that and build those relationships with young people and build them as people, as citizens, using sport to build them to help reconcile our society. That's the key. How do we use the sport that we all love so well to actually build a much richer and vibrant society that people can live and work and play together?
I think we have a question from the audience. We actually have two. Oh my God, we've loads. so we'll get a microphone over to you there. Since I have a Britney Spears mic, I could sing to do the gap, but it's fine.
Hi. Thanks very much. Somebody has to go first. My name is Graham Clifford. I'm the founder of the Sanctuary Runners. We use running, jogging and walking to bring together asylum seekers, refugees, migrants and those in wider Irish society. We also have a group in Mill Street. We climb the mountain after running on a Saturday, the mountain near Mill Street. So the cricket pitch will come. It could be on the top of a mountain. But anyway, and I suppose my question is, you know, I always get really frustrated and it's why I set up the Sanctuary Runners. I get frustrated by the words that are the right words to use. You know, when you're talking about inclusion and diversity and bringing people together and community bridge building and so on. And it sounds wonderful. And there's dialogues and there's policies and every NGO produces annual reports. And this is always the aspiration. And the aspiration is applauded and that's great. But on the ground, from the bottom up, I suppose I don't see it happening. You know, what's on paper doesn't match what's happening on the ground. For example, you know, the second biggest, the biggest migrant group in the country at the moment are Polish, is the Polish community. And I wonder how many Polish people are here or representative or online. Fourth biggest, or third biggest rather, Lithuanian, similar. And I get frustrated that, you know, we talk about these community bridge building, sometimes without having all the information, sometimes not realizing there's a lot we don't know. And the only way really to properly find out is to go out and ask, and to do it in a proper way rather than a tokenistic kind of way. There's a real lack of multilingual communication with groups and a lack of understanding the cultural differences that exist and that are barriers to participation and access in sport. And I'm also mindful that as we talk now, there are people making their way to borders in Hungary and Slovakia and also Poland from the Ukraine. And inevitably, a lot of Ukrainian people will end up coming to Ireland. And we'll have to be ready for that too, and agile enough to use sport as a way to bring everybody together. So my question, I've eventually got to it, is would the panel agree that that there's a lack of understanding of migrant communities and cultures in Ireland on both sides of the border, which can impact that vital community building through sport? We're all able to name different sports people from different ethnic backgrounds who've done well in Ireland, but I mean from the grassroots up, from mom and dad, bringing the person to the game, not just the participant, but the people behind the participant. Thank you very much.
Elaine, do you want to take that one, given you've worked with some of the minority groups?
Yeah, there is a limitation of understanding, and I think we've certainly learned through a 24-month process, and this is somewhere some of the places we failed is not fully in understanding the limitations of, say, asylum seekers in direct provision and the time that they have in the day to be able to dedicate to sport. Or we tried to during COVID to deliver online webinars and online training, but actually their broadband strength in the evenings when everybody's home from school was too low to be able to effectively do it. So what we started doing was actually having those conversations and doing kind of customer discovery of, you know, actually sitting down and talking to the agencies that are dealing. And we have a good relationship with UCC and the Carl Research Project, who helped us and did a paper on direct provision and sports and how it can support the Bridge Project in Galway. So it's all about learning. Have we got all the answers yet? No. Are we a little bit slower? Yes, but you know, I'd love to have a conversation with you afterwards of your learnings and knowledge. And I think that knowledge sharing is so vitally important on how we approach this, and how we actually come together. We're talking about connecting communities. Well, it's connecting conversations now, isn't it, to make sure that we are getting the impact on the ground, and it's not that transactional, we're doing the right thing, we're ticking the box. We're actually genuinely having the conversations with the communities that need it. And supporting that. I think that the conversation is moving, and it's going to move at pace now, because there is a huge amount of engagement. And I think both Sport and I and Sport Ireland are really focusing on these things and supporting with funding to make sure the right conversation has been had, and that it is participant-led and it's not just sport-led at the moment.
Do you have anything to add, Maura?
Yeah, I suppose, and Jerry McTavish is here. She's our Diversity and Inclusion Officer with National GAA, and I know working very closely with SARI and the likes of those organisations as well. And back to what Elaine's saying, the conversation's definitely moving at pace when you actually start to see the impact of that and the fallout of that within your club. So, you know, our membership and so on, it does take time. It actually takes sometimes generations. But if you have your sport in your local community, embedded in your community, in your local schools, and you have a good link between your school and your club, for example, those kids are in our schools. Those parents will then come and support their kids if they're, you know, if they've had a good experience of your sport, they're down playing in their local club, whatever that sport is, and they come along and play. And then it's about how that club then can embrace the parents by bringing in other activities. You know, they probably won't, you know, they may not play our sport if they're only here, you know, for a short time. Have been here for a short time, but certainly if the kids are having a good experience, they're embedded in their community because they're in their because their club's embedded in their community, it's only natural that that will come. But it takes time, so, and it is about then that we give them the right experience when they are in our clubs. And there's so much work ongoing in that area as well, but so much still, you know, still so much still to do, and it's a very evolving kind of paradigm as well, as you've said.
Yeah. Jim, I'm curious to get your point of view, because I notice a lot of the conversation around bringing in people together from different communities, it involves someone to stick their head out and be the doer. You were the doer for so long, you know, in Derry. How hard is it to be the person that literally raises your head above the pulpit and says, yeah, I'll do it, I'll take on everyone's burdens all in one go?
Well, again, as Gareth has said earlier on, you know, when you're entering the sport, there's always things that you're going to fail at. So failure isn't the end game. If you believe in strong enough, you have to keep going. But I go back to the question, John. I think the question is actually, you know, a template for what we should be doing. And you know, and there are things that's taken so long to do. Even we look at soccer. Look how long it took us to develop the idea of ladies football and where ladies football's at now, and bring it to a parity to where they were men's footballs at. I think it's the same with minority ethnic communities as well, and how we plan to include them in everything we do, not just in sport, but using sport again as a vehicle. As I talk about soccer being a universal sport that's played right throughout the world, and it's so easy to play, and it's very inclusive. The game itself is very inclusive, but are the administrators as inclusive? I include myself in that when I was involved in the game. I don't think we probably were. I think we need to concentrate more on being inclusive and ensuring that everybody gets the opportunity to participate, because that participation itself builds relations and builds society, and that's what's so important. And using sport to build society, the society that we need, is so important.
Yeah, I totally agree. We do have a question online. It's Eileen Weir, I hope I pronounced that right, chairperson of Women is Sport and Physical Activity. WISPA, I know it's going to take a couple of seconds to get her on the screen to tell her question. So if you don't mind, I'll just probably ask, you know, Maura, obviously the failure is the most important thing, and I think we've obviously addressed that at the moment. How difficult is it to actually embrace it? Because you don't want to fail, I assume, when you go into these schools. You don't want to have the pushback. You want it to be all nice and lovely. And it's going to be harsh sometimes, unfortunately. So, like, how do you literally pick yourself up every morning and go, okay, we'll go again?
Yeah, that's a very good question. And I suppose it really comes down to what the ethos is of your sport, what it is you're actually trying to do. And you probably just sometimes have to focus on that bigger picture and remain, as I said before, like resilient in the fact that if you know the thing that you're trying to do is the correct thing to do, well, then you have to persist and do it for the reasons that you ever chose to start on that journey at all. maybe the way you're doing it isn't correct. So it is about being able to be flexible and adapt, and, you know, as I said, maybe move around obstacles rather than going through them and so on. So I think being flexible is a huge important part of that, but certainly that takes a bit of resource as well. So the importance of the funding and the investment in sport is a huge thing. I think even to have bodies on the ground to be physically able to make those phone calls to schools or to clubs or to other groups and so on. So yeah, I think it is about being adaptable and really just staying true to what it is that you're trying to do at the same time.
Yeah. This is my wannabe Marty Whelan moment. We've got Eileen on the line. Eileen, if you want to ask your question.
Yeah, I'm getting a wee bit of feedback here. I am a chairperson of WISPA at Swimming and Sport and Physical Activity. And we set this up because a lot of people who love their sport but not good enough to get on a team. And there's big concerns that sport is about team sport and being on the team and being on the first 11. And we have a lot of youth that's being told they're not good enough. And really, I think when we're talking about sport, it's about getting people fit and getting people active. I think we forget about the physical activity side of that. There's a lot of people that, you know, I've played sport all my life. I'm a hockey player and have played hockey all my life. And, you know, my friends that weren't picked for the team thought they were worthless. So I would like to see something put in place for those youth who love to kick the ball or love to play hockey or love to play netball, love to play basketball, that there's tournaments set up for those who are not just good enough to be on the first 11 team. And I think if we concentrate on the best of the elite, then we are missing an awful lot of our youth that need the help even more so. Than those who get onto the first 11 team, because it can't be soul destroying. You know, we do football tournaments with teams, and we have two sections, one who can and one who can't. And the ones who can't get to enjoy the sport as well, because they're playing against people who can't also, but they love the sport. So I think we just need to focus a wee bit more on not just the competitive side. Well, all sports competitive, but not about winning medals or winning cups or winning trophies or winning Commonwealth Games or winning the Olympics. A lot of our youth who need it the most are being neglected.
Elaine, that's probably something you see as well in your work, like who you're working with aren't exactly going to be cricketers maybe for Ireland, but you are trying to cultivate the new leaders. Like, how do you manage to separate the wannabe elites from the, I just want to have the chats
and have the fun? Yeah. You know, I think it's making sure that you're offering covers all of those eventualities, and you would hope that most sports look, or all sports look, to the participation, and then they have their pathway component, which then supports those with the desire and the skill set to be able to go on to the elite sport without kind of dropping off any youth or kids who, you know, aren't going to make that pathway, that it's all about fun and enjoyment and experience. And it's really important to have that engagement so that we keep people active all the way through their life cycle up to, you know, whenever, you know, we're just going to introduce walking cricket in the next couple of weeks. We've taken it from the UK. So we're hoping that people can extend their cricket playing for a lot longer. But, you know, I think it's so important that we don't select too early. And that we, you know, advocate, and as sports collectively advocate for multi-sport, because it actually does then create, you know, the better elite athlete at the other end, but that we're keeping people engaged in the sport all the way through.
Jim, I know we spoke about that a little bit as well on the phone earlier, how you have to keep the 99% interested because only 1% will go over to play for the Premier League. And you had mentioned about making sure that facilities across the island of Ireland look like what the kids aspire to play to. How important do you think that is? And is that really important to keep the youth interested, the ones who aren't going to be going over to the Premier League?
Yeah, well, look, the facilities are a big thing, especially when it comes to soccer. We have 19 clubs that play within the FAA and 35 clubs that play within the Irish League in the north. You know, amongst the population of Ireland, which is just under 7 million, you know, and that's a lot of investment, and that's a lot of government money spent on just the elite clubs. And if you take it back to what Eileen was talking about the inclusivity, And I would argue that we need to use the elite athletes, and we need to use the sport to be inclusive. And it's not all about being on the first team. There's so many things that go on in and around sport, working on their own sport, being inclusive, educating through sport, getting different types of life skills through sport. And it's using that sport in a proper way that can be inclusive at all times. But look, it is always going to end up that it is going to be the first team that's picked. It is always going to end up that competitive spirit. But it's about embracing that and making sure that we don't leave people out and make people feel as though they're failures. But when it comes to facilities, Joanne, within soccer on the island of Ireland, our you know, Irish League and League of Ireland soccer clubs do not have facilities like we have elsewhere in the UK or even right throughout the world. And it's something that I think needs severe look at and real investment. And that can only happen, as I say, if there's a target investment in the game. And hopefully then kids can come with their parents to have great times at football stadia, enjoy the show that's on offer, go out back into the streets and the parks and play and talk about the game they enjoy. And then during the day, come back to these clubs, get educated with these clubs, you know, build relationships with these clubs, get to know other people. And you know, but it's not all about winning and the elite athlete. It has to be inclusive, but the elite athlete and winning is going to be part of it and part person.
Yeah, I totally agree. Apologies, obviously, for the noise. Like the TG Cahir weathermen, we can't control the weather. So sincere apologies for that. We do have a question here at the front, if someone can dash with a microphone. Oh, we got it.
This is a pleasure to have a microphone brought to me instead of fighting for the microphone. thanks for giving me some help, Joanna. I'm Ken McHugh. I'm a cultural planner with Sport Against Racism. And Graham actually used a lot of my lines, so I'll cut it very short. A question for Jim. Jim, I'm sure you were surprised to see that in terms of the All-Ireland League, that the FAI in the strategic plan completely ignored the All-Ireland League. And I know Derry City are 100% behind it. I was up yesterday in Belfast, in East Belfast, with our partners in Glentoran Football Club, talking about they call it the Belfast Agreement, by the way. It just happened on Good Friday. But what was interesting about that was they can bring 60, you know yourself, they can bring 6,000 fans, including Linfield can do the same, Cliftonville the same, to Dublin and Cork for games. So look at, why haven't the FAI recognised the fact that AIL is a really important development? Secondly, the Glentoran are coming to the Minister's constituency in May to reopen the Glentoran Academy in Blanchardstown. Now that's going to be, again, a lot of migrant kids will be involved in that, and that's going to be a great bonus for the area. In terms of Lane and the cricket, I'd like to ask her about the follow-on from the direct provision centres, which should be closed down, by the way, immediately. The cricket development is really interesting. Outside of the DPCs, when people leave the DPC, like in Tirlestown, again, in the Minister's constituency, just across the road, they have set up the Tirlestown Cricket Club. It's incredible, and it's bringing people from all different backgrounds, migrant backgrounds together and others. And the same with Carlo, with the Rohingya community that we work with, who've re-established the Carlo Cricket Club and become champions of the county. So again, just a comment on that, and Jim, comment on the All-Ireland League. And the fact that you mentioned the fact that we can't send an All-Ireland team to tournaments, but in actual fact we can, and it's called the Olympic Games, where we can send a North-South team to the Olympic Games. We may miss out on Paris, but certainly the next one. Thanks.
Jim, do you want to take that first?
Yeah, well, look, listen, Ken, thank you. And Glentoran are an excellent club, and the work that they do within East Belfast is superb. And I work very closely with Stafford Reynolds there when we were talking about the formation of an All-Ireland League. And I know that they were very supportive of looking at the context. Obviously, the final detail would be very important to them. But the most important thing is they're football people. They want to bring people together. It's people at the core. It's young people at the core. It's not about the only identity they have is the club that they love. but it's about using that identity in a way that brings people together. And it is uniting in the sense that it's uniting people, and that's so vitally important, and using sport to do that. But it's also about creating that league where there's a proper investment. You were in the Oval yesterday, Ken, obviously, and what you see is a stadium that's so massively lacking investment, And we're trying to attract our local people to our local games. And you're quite right. Glentoran are doing very well at the moment, and their most recent game with Linfield was a sellout. We're playing Shamrock Rovers here on tomorrow night, and our tickets were sold out before the start of this week. And so the people are yearning for that excitement, for those big games where people want to come and go away and talk about all week, and then get young people involved in that as well. There's nothing more uniting than a community coming together through sport in that way. And I just don't know why it isn't in the strategic plan. I don't know why in 2008, when Drury and myself brought this to the FBI, they weren't interested at the time. The time wasn't right. As we talked before, you know, sport's all about, you know, failures and wanting and picking yourself up and getting on with it. This is too important. And even if we make mistakes along the way, we must learn by it and build. And you build it, they will say, and you build it, they will come. And I honestly believe the creation of an All-Ireland Football League, where we get young people aspiring to attend all the stadiums in Ireland, as well as going to the stadiums in the UK, but attending all the stadiums in Ireland that are fit for the 22nd or 20th year 2022, and have all the mod cons and serve the local community. Most importantly, Colchester, other clubs have done this. They've built a stadium that serves the local community as well. So using sport to serve that community and building community resilience is so vitally important. But Ken, you know, 100% with you and everything you said.
Elaine, I think the question for you was the aftermath of working with the people in direct provision centres. What have you noticed? Is there any follow-up?
We're building the capacity so that they're going to kind of deliver themselves, but actually there's been a lot of club engagement as well. So we've run a program across clubs over the last probably 8 months of intercultural training and unconscious bias and inclusion. So we've been running webinars with our clubs during COVID, and actually it's opened up a number of clubs across the country who have kind of recognized the limitations for people about the days of the week that they work. Saturdays aren't traditionally cricketers being able to play, so midweek leagues, and just kind of considering how their traditional structure has always worked to how they need to modify it to allow new members come into the environment. Tyrrellstown is one of the fastest growing clubs in the Leinster region, as is Adamstown. Huge community, really engaged and brilliant club. And we're seeing that more and more. And we want to ensure that cricket is actually opening itself up to everybody, that it can be, you know, whether you're a player or a volunteer or just utilizing the facility as a community facility, I think it's really important. And we've just partnered with the Irish Centre of Diversity to kind of build that framework and to really kind of benchmark ourselves about where we are as organizations, but also from a stakeholder engagement point of view. We're going to be running kind of national survey plus focus groups of ensuring that we're building a sport that is for what Ireland looks like now. Because I think kind of a stat from Leinster, 70% of people who play cricket in Leinster learnt the sport outside of Ireland. And have we adapted ourselves to allow them to flourish and engage? And we're making those steps to do so.
Yeah, that's incredibly interesting. I just want to remind everyone that if you are in the audience, you can raise your hand, a microphone will come to you, and it's very quiet online. I feel like a jilted lover up here. So if you do want to ask a question, raise your hand with the button at the bottom, put it in the chat function, and I will get to it as well. Maura, I suppose there's a massive conversation at the moment about LGFA, Camogie, GAA all merging into one. We had the GPA launching their proposal for Congress this weekend. St. McCartan's, which is your club, is one of the few clubs that's involved in the healthy clubs within the GAA. How can we get more LGFA clubs? If they merge, they mightn't be LGFA anymore. But how can we get more, I suppose, ladies football teams or Camogie teams even active within the healthy club webinars?
Yeah, I suppose there's two kind of questions in that. It's like any club, I suppose, getting involved in a healthy club project. It's very much to do with having the capacity through your volunteers and so on to take on that additional work, because, you know, certainly for clubs that maybe haven't done a lot of volunteers, that energy goes into coaching and fundraising, the usual things that we need to keep the club afloat and going. But certainly then as clubs, you know, build capacity, get more volunteers, they do tend to take on these additional roles of, and they see the value and they can put invest in things like the health and wellbeing agenda. So you'd hope that they would eventually come into the Healthy Club programme. In terms of will there be LGFA clubs in the future, I know the one club model, and I know it's I know Tom's in the audience from the GPA also, so it's great to see even the merging of, you know, the GPA coming all under one to represent all the codes, or the female code as well. Yeah, and I mean the way forward, of course, it is for integration. As you said, my local club is a standalone ladies club, and again it was just probably formed on the basis of we have three men's GA, or not men's, but we have three GA clubs, and the population from those small, very rural areas can only really manage one club for ladies football. And that's the way we've been. If integration comes, you know, when we become one club model, we'll probably have to choose which of our three GA clubs then we will affiliate under and so on. So there's lots of little things that we do need to, you know, pan out, and there's lots of discussions that need to happen, and I know they're really ongoing and so on. So, but those are governance kind of things, which I suppose this is what it's going to come down to, and that's where the big move will be. But at a local level, it's like anything, a club will make it work, because essentially we're just governed differently. We are one club because we represent our local community, and that's the way it is. So it will be just the practical things of governance that will be the stumbling block. But in terms of what is the way forward, certainly integration and one club is the way to go.
And what do you think are those stumbling blocks? I suppose the administration level really is it. Yeah. Like at the moment you've got, I suppose you could have a daughter and a son and you're paying three different types of insurance if they decide to play with all their clubs. You've also got the funding, you've got the equal access to facilities. What do you think are some of the, are they the main stumbling blocks, or how do you want
to? Yeah, you've probably nailed it, Joanne. Those seem to be the thing. I mean, you're playing different registrations. It means that if, you know, your daughter picks up an ACL injury or your son picks up an ACL injury, that could be treated a wee bit differently just in terms of, because there's two different insurance schemes and so on. So those are just some of the issues that need to be, you know, teased out. I'm sure like there's so much work has gone into that. But like if you're that mother driving your son, your daughter to their training, you don't see them as being any different. And you want the best for both of them. You want them to get as much opportunity to excel as far as they can, or if they just choose to participate or pick daisies or whatever it is that they want to do, that's what you want, and you don't see a difference between your son or your daughter in the back of the car. So I think, as you know, as this all moves forward, that's I suppose the vision, that everyone will be treated equally and we will become integrated.
Yeah, and your under 14 girls won't have to look at your under 12 boys on the lovely pitch and they're on the soaked soddy turf in the background and you're like, well, this is automatically set up for life now. If anyone has any questions from the audience, we have a microphone already.
Hello everybody. I'm representing the Orienteering Association, which is a minority sport, and we are looking to build capacity and resources. But I'd like to go back to a point that Maura made earlier about collaborating with other sports. And do you think there's an appetite to work with, say, smaller sports to provide some support or mentoring? And if there is an appetite, how best to go about it? It's a general to all of the panelists. I suppose the advantage of working with different sports is you get different skills, and it builds the person as the youth or the older person in a more holistic sense, and they can then go on to either just get involved in participation or to get involved at an elite level, but that they're bringing a variety of skills to build their resilience for their future.
Do you want to take that one more?
And again, the collaboration that we have with the Irish FA, Ulster Rugby and ourselves has allowed us over time, again, these things do take time. We have an excellent youth volunteering programme ongoing, the Sports Inspire Award. And that really, it's from about 16 to 24 year olds who come together. And through that programme, yes, they will enter it through their sport of choice, so one of the three. And then they get loads of opportunities to volunteer with other sports. So some of those young people will naturally be doing that anyway, but that program brings them through and gives them loads of opportunities. So for example, to go to a stadium that they've never been before in a sport they've never had an experience of before. And you're right, it brings on so many more skills, more knowledge, but just that personal develop all, development, all those softer skills around getting to know people, getting outside their comfort zone, mixing with different peers, all of those things. So collaboration in that has been really, really beneficial to our volunteers. And, you know, those are the young people that will come through in, you know, 10 or 20 years time to probably be the officers and the top people within our clubs, counties, even in governing body level. So the more of that we can do, the better. Absolutely.
I think we have time for one final question. I think this guy at the front, awkward sprint down. Oh, there's a microphone coming. You're all right. You're good. We'll keep it as brief as we can.
Yeah, just thanks very much. Hugo McNeil's my name. Just really congratulations to all of you, and actually into the Taoiseach and the inspiration behind this, because of bringing together the things that can bind people and my own sport. And it's a pity Andrew Trimble wasn't here today, but just I've heard him speak so well. And the rugby was that it continues to build relationships right across these islands, independent of where people's background, independence, what people's identity was. And it's always worth us constantly reminding ourselves of that, because in the unfinished parts of the Good Friday Agreement was the mutual respect, the tolerance and reconciliation, and sport has a huge role in that. And so congratulations to everyone today and everyone, how articulate you've been, but that's something that we will be constantly grateful and keep after working on.
Jim, do you have any thoughts to add to that, especially about the mutual respect parts of the Good Friday Agreement?
I think the last speaker said it all. It's how we utilise the sports that we're involved in to make better citizens of all the people who share these islands. And you know, reconciliation is a major part of that. And it's amazing, you know, whilst people may have differences, whether it be, you know, ethnicity differences, cultural differences, or whatever, sport can be a great uniting theme. And we need to keep sport at the core of that unity theme, and making sure that the individual is at the pinnacle of all of that. And each individual that we work with, it's all about making them a better citizen. And certainly soccer needs to play its part in it, from the associations right down to all the clubs. The work that GAA do is an exemplar for working within communities, and so much more that the rest of us can do. And cricket in Ireland has seen such a growth in the last while, and how our national team's doing has been superb. But how do we turn that into making better citizens of all the people who share these islands? And that's something that I'm keenly interested in.
I think everyone on the panel and everyone here, I think we're all keen on making good citizens, people who can work together in the future. And I suppose that's what sport can do. It can bring all these people together. I'd obviously like to thank everyone for their questions, for putting them in. But most importantly, I'd like to thank our panelists, Jim, all the way up in Derry. We've also got Elaine Nolan and Maura McMenamin. And yeah, thank you so much for your time. We really do appreciate it.